Hello, I'm Paul McCormick. I'm a culinary instructor here at the Community College of Philadelphia's Culinary Arts and Hospitality Management program. Today, we're going to make snapper soup. This is not to be confused with red snapper the fish. This is snapping turtle, wild-caught snapping turtle. It's a Philadelphia tradition. Let me start with the turtle. Okay, this is a snapping turtle. It's caught wild in the marshes, the lowlands, the ponds, the lakes, the streams, all around this area in the Delaware Valley, Delaware, South Jersey, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. We have two rivers in Philadelphia, the Delaware and the Schuylkill. Both of these can, this animal can be caught in both rivers rather easily. They're easy to trap. They don't move very fast. They are bottom dwellers, so they'll eat whatever comes in front of them. They're not aggressive predators. They'll wait and have lunch come to them. To begin with, the first thing we do is it's been washed. I've already washed this and rinsed this off. When it comes out, there's a little bit of blood left in it. But what I do is it's already rinsed and washed. So I'm gonna take this and put this into my roasting pan. All right, because the first step in the 3-day process is roasting the turtle. Just like I would roast a piece of meat or a turkey or any other piece of flesh that I'm gonna roast before I eat it. So the same thing will happen. I'll put it in the pan. Now, just like adding a roast, I'm going to add mirepoix, a collection of vegetables that are going to add flavor and texture to the dish, to the soup. And just like I add it to a stock, I all want it to add flavor, but I'm going to roast it as well. I'll start off with leeks. I have to wash the leeks and I have to wash the celery because, just like I've explained before, it grows open like this, and wind and dirt bring all sorts of sand and debris into the leek. Leek is an onion that I like using for soup. It's a little bit sweeter. It cooks differently than onions. It has less cellulose, but a lot more flavor. But what I'll do is I'll take my tops off. I usually reserve these for stock, but they're very sandy. I'm going to split it lengthwise. Okay, because I'm going to use the leek again in the finished soup, but this is for my stock. So let me cut these on the angle like this. I'm going to rinse these in a bowl. And when I wash these, you're going to see the amount of sand that comes out of the bottom of these leeks. I want them to come out. I don't want the sand, obviously, but I do want the flavor of the leeks. Cold water. And as I rinse these, the sand will fall out of the bottom and end up in the bottom of the bowl. I have to agitate them, separate them all up, and I mean, I have to move them around a lot so all the sand's heavier than the water, the leeks will float and all the sand will fall and drip to the bottom. And when I'm done with this, the leeks I'm going to put all over the bottom of the pan with the turtle, but I want all of the sand to be out of here. In order to have that happen, I'll agitate it the same way I agitate students. It's kind of what I do. I want the sand to fall to the bottom. But as we finish this, you'll see that a lot of sand does fall. When I'm done, I'll pour the water off and show you the sand that ended up in the bottom. I'm just going to cover the turtle with these. I'm going to do the same thing with the carrots and the celery. Just going to peel the carrots. This will all turn into flavor because as I roast it, like I've roasted vegetables in the past, I add a different type of flavor, different things happen. From all the leeks, from that leek, I have all this sand, the sand that comes in the bottom. I don't want that, obviously, so I'm going to take that, put that in the sink. I'm going to cut up some celery, 5 or 6 ribs. I'm going to roast this again. I'm not going to use this for my finished soup product. Rough cut. I don't have to really cut it down very much. Add another 2 ribs. This will end up not only in the turtle, but it'll end up in the stock. And the stock is one of my building blocks for a soup. Just like step one of roasting the turtle, step two will be making the stock. These vegetables I'll actually repeat when I make the stock. Okay, carrots. 1 carrot, take the top off. I'm actually going to use the top. I'm actually going to keep this. I've already washed this. I'm just going to cut it. Larger chunks. Because as I roast it, the sugars in the carrots are going to come out, change the flavor and texture of the carrot, and it will add to the stock when I make stock from the same roasted turtle. Garlic peeled whole. Just throw that in. The flavor of roasted garlic is tremendous, tremendously different than raw garlic or sauteed garlic. Raw garlic, some parsley. Onion, regular yellow onion, just sweet onion. Okay, larger chunks. Doesn't have to be cut small. It's actually going to end up changing the flavor and color. Roasted onions, roasted vegetables tend to have a different nuttier flavor. I'll have a red onion too. So carrots, onions, and celery, leeks. So I basically have three types of onions. I have garlic. Aromatics, they're called. I'm going to add parsley. I'm going to add bay leaf. Now, I'm going to put this around the edge of the turtle, not on the shell itself. I can actually mix this with the vegetables. This will give me a more caramel color. Okay. I didn't add salt. I can always add salt. I can't take any away. The stock, I'll put a little bit of salt in the stock, and salt will increase in a savory flavor later on. But for this part of the process, I'm not even going to use salt. I'm ready to put this in the oven now. This is the finished product ready to go in the oven. The shell is on the top, which is protecting the meat inside. That's basically what I want. When seafood or meat gets really, really tough, it's because too much high heat causes the proteins to join together and tighten up. Slower, lower heat is better, but I do want this caramelized, so I'll start it off at a 400 degree oven, and after about 15 minutes after the top browns, I'll turn it down to a 300 oven. So I'm gonna drop 100 degrees off so it roasts a little slower, but ends up still caramelizing, but ends up slower so I don't make the meat too tough. It's ready to go in the oven. Now, it's time for step two of the process. I roasted the turtle. Time to take it out of the oven. Okay. This is my roasted turtle. As you can see, it's in a different pan. For the sake of this video, I turned around and had two turtles. Now, I'm going to show you what the cooked meat looks like inside the turtle. I'm going to flip the shell up just like I did when the turtle was raw. And now there's a huge difference in the way it looks. The inside of the shell has meat running along the bone. This is how brown that the tomato paste that I put underneath the shell turned. So this is really, really nice and dark. The meat looks darker, okay? It's fully cooked all the way through, all right? The skin turned really dark, but that's a misnomer. The skin is actually covering the flesh. The flesh of a fish or even a reptile that swims and lives its life in the water is always gonna be lighter than a land animal. That's always based on the fact that they need less myoglobin to move. Myoglobin is the chemical process that happens to protein when muscles move slowly. When muscles you move fast, like a turkey's breast or a chicken's breast, who are non-flight birds, flap their wings to evade a predator, the muscle tissue doesn't get the slow-moving muscle use that creates myoglobin. Fish, because of the buoyancy of the water, never get really, really dark meat. So this is still gonna be light meat. People say, turtle, what's it taste like? Oh, it tastes like chicken. It doesn't taste like chicken. It has a very earthy flavor, and that's a nice term for what some people react to that earthy flavor. It's just the fact that the myoglobin, because of there's less muscle movement, is lighter in color. And that's why people say, it tastes like chicken. It's generally an animal or a fish or another creature that doesn't use its muscles very much for slow movement. Rapid movement, yes, not slow movement. So our medium light colored flesh is still inside, protected by the shell and by the skin as I roasted it. So we're gonna have this for the stock. Let me put this in the stock pot. Okay, I'm gonna lift the turtle out. It's hot, of course. Okay, the turtle in itself, into the pot. Now, as you can see underneath, I have all these beautiful vegetables that are roasted, darker in color, okay, soft. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to do something in culinary terms we call deglaze the pan. Now, to deglaze the pan, what I generally do is take a liquid, hot or cold, and I put it into the hot roasting pan and I put it on the stove and let all of the liquid release all of the caramelized vegetables, proteins, and everything that is this flavor in the bottom of the roasted vegetables and the roasted essence of the turtle that's still stuck to the pan. I want that all out of there because that's what's going to flavor my stock, because part two of the three-day process is making the stock. The stock is the building block for making the soup, the finished soup. So what I have to do now is put this on the stove on a flame and actually start to cook this again, almost like sauteing. But I'm going to add some sherry wine and some stock to release all of these flavors that are in here and add it to the stock pot. And then I'll add water to cover. I'm going to make a slow stock. We'll explain that at that next step of the process. This is going on the stove. Okay. Turn my flame on. Turn them down to medium. I have stock up here. I'm going to start with stock to deglaze. This is regular turkey stock. Right? This is boiling already because the pan's already hot. That's enough. I'm going to add some sherry wine to this. Sherry wine for the flavor, because a fortified wine like sherry is going to add a really unique flavor to it. Plus, it's darker. Looks like tea. It's not a clear white wine, it's not a red wine, it's brownish. I'm going to use my spoon and I want to remove as much of this from the bottom of the pan as possible. And this will make a very brown, very rich looking stock. The flame and the heat is helping to release this from the bottom of the pan. Beautiful. This process of deglazing is something we use when we saute. Anytime that we're adding a lot of heat to protein or cellulose, you're going to have a chemical change and a physical change in the product that makes it stick to the pan. That's generally that caramelization is what we go for, because that chemical change usually increases the flavor. Okay, all of my vegetables are going into my stock pot, and as you can see, everything that came out of the pot doesn't stick. It's actually pretty clean. And that's because when I deglazed, the glaze that sticks is what I wanted to take out. So I deglazed the pan so I'd end up with a beautiful looking clean pan that doesn't have a lot of things stuck to it. And I used all of that essence in my soup. Now, my stock pot. This pot is actually called a braiser. A braiser is what we use to make slow roasted, pot roast, or dishes that we're going to cook with a lot of liquid and cook slow. This is the original crock pot. I'm going to make a stock from this. Now, we still have the same three rules we use for stock. We never boil it, we never stir it, and we never cover it. So I don't need the cover for the braiser. But I do need a pot that's lower, flatter, and rounder to fit the whole turtle. Most stock pots are tall and cylindrical because you're putting bits and pieces in, not usually a whole piece. So I'm changing the pot to make the stock work for the product that I'm making. But in real terms, most snapping turtles are huge. This braiser wouldn't fit a normal roasting turtle. The average turtle that gets harvested is usually about 40 to 50 pounds dressed. They're huge. For the sake of this product and making the turtles right, I got the smallest turtles available. So right now, I'm gonna add the rest of my stock to this to cover this up to the point where the shell is just about submerged so I can make enough stock for the soup. My stock is ready. I'm going to actually just pour the rest of the stock over the top. This part of the process is actually kind of important that I get this right, because just like I used my three rules, I don't want to boil this. I want it to come up to a boil and I'm going to reduce it to a simmer, but I still have to add some more liquids. I'll just add water. The stock is flavorful enough. I'm gonna count on the fact that I have my beautiful seasoning, I have my vegetables and my stock. I'm gonna add some more vegetables to this to help punch up and boost up the flavor that I'm gonna have in the stock. This is enough water to cover. And I'm going to make now the satchel that I talked about before in step one with the spices. Let me put this on the stove. I'm going to turn this on and start the process. But while I'm waiting, I'm going to take 2 pieces of cooking equipment that should be in every cook's box, and that is butcher's twine and cheesecloth. These two things are what I'm going to use to make my satchel of spices. I'm going to cut a nice chunk of cheesecloth, and I always wet my cheesecloth before I make a spice bag, before I even use this to strain a sauce. I always want the cheesecloth wet, because I'm going to open this up and then fold it so it's in, so I have a double layer. This, I strain fine sauces through cheesecloth, because before we had beautiful metal sieves, straining things through cloth was a great way to do things. But as I make this, the spices, the satchel of spices, it's really kind of important that when I do this, I get the flavor out, but none of the little seeds or leaves. The seeds are all tough. I use coriander. Now, I can't give away the spice. The spice is one of the stories of making a snapper soup. In the Philadelphia tradition, there's a restaurant called Bookbinders that was famous for making snapper soup. And here again, I had said before that it was a dish reserved for royalty, and a lot of it had to do with the fact that it is difficult, it's time consuming, so the only people who could afford to pay a chef like myself to make the soup was somebody who was rich, because we had to put a lot of effort into this. Here's my spice mixture. I'm going to pour a nice little lump in here. Then I'm going to roll it up, and I'm going to make a satchel, and I'm going to tie it off with a piece of butcher's twine. Now, this spice, seasonings are the most expensive thing that we can put in any dish, mainly because for the weight that they have, they're the most expensive because we don't use a lot of them. And a pound of saffron, for example, which is a different herb, it's very expensive because it's made by hand. It's picked by hand from the stamen of a crocus, and then it's sold. And spice used to be used as currency. You can see right now that the moisture that I wet the cheesecloth with right now is actually making the satchel look green. That's the sage, that's the marjoram, and the thyme actually getting the water absorbing and starting to rehydrate. This satchel of turtle spice, and you can actually buy turtle spice, it's hard to find, and the blend, nobody gives up their secret as to what the proportions of seasonings are in the turtle blend. I'm going to show you the company, one of the companies that I use to make it. 3 or 4 companies, including McCormick Spices, no relation, will make this turtle blend for you at special request. You're going to have to buy a significant amount, and you're going to have to make a lot of turtle spice. Most of the places who make turtle soup or Philadelphia-style snapper soup buy this in bulk, and they use it in bulk. This is probably a golf ball size ball of the seasoning. I can blend this myself. It takes a lot of time and money to make the turtle blend, especially if you're not using it all the time. So for convenience sake, I'm going to buy prepared turtle blend. Let me put this little satchel right in my stock. Okay, it looks like a wet sock. It's going to be like a wet sock, but that's going to impart so much flavor into my stock, it's kind of vital. All right, I'm going to add the rest of some of these vegetables in, another carrot. This will help me fortify what I'm doing. All right. This is going to fortify the rest of my stock. I'll add another onion. I'm not going to add leeks at this point because I don't want to go through the whole sand process. I just want to get the vegetables in. I'm going to add leeks as one of the garnishes at the end of the soup. So I'm going to saute them when I do my vegetables for the part 3 of the snapper soup. And one more onion. As this soup cooks, as the stock cooks, is when I can start getting together my garnish for finishing the soup. This will take probably 1.5 hours to make the stock come up to where I need it. When this stock is done, I'm going to clean the turtle meat. Cleaning the turtle meat is really an essential part of what we do. It comes out of the pot hot. I put it in a pan. I let it get as cool enough so I can touch it. I can touch things that are very, very hot. But you have to let it cool first before you pick the meat apart. If it gets cold, it's harder to clean. Anyone who makes soup with chicken or anything knows, or any other animal knows, it's easier to clean the meat from the bones when it's warm than it is when it's cold. When it's cold, it'll contract and actually stick to the bones. So we have to clean this when it's still warm. It's gonna take, the stock is nice and brown, it's gonna take about an hour and a half. In that hour and a half, while I'm waiting for the stock to finish, I'm going to work on the parts of the soup that I need for garnish, and I'll explain them in a minute. Now it's time, while the stock is on the stove, I'm going to make the garnishes for my finished soup. The vegetables that I use for the stock are usually the peels, the ends, the bottoms, the part that I'm not going to use on the finished plate I put in the stock. For our soup to be beautiful and have garnish, in other words, more texture than just the liquid and something to complement the balance of the meat, I want to have some nice looking vegetables that I'm going to put in that I already have in the stock that complement the turtle meat that's in the soup. I'm going to use leeks, carrots, celery, and onions. Mirepoix, exactly what I usually put in the soup. Let me start. I'm going to start with leeks. I'm going to do the same thing I did with the leeks when I made the stock. I'm going to cut them to size, rinse them, drain them, make sure all the sand comes off of them, and then I'm going to saute them with everything else before I add them to the soup. Let me start with the leeks. Dirty, sandy, I want to get all the sand off. Cut the hairy ends off. I'm going to make little juliennes. To make them the same length, I'm going to cut them just like this. In order to get them all the same size, I line them up with my knife, so when I cut the next section, it looks exactly the same. That's how I get a nice uniform, even julienne. To get this right, I'll move these parts aside. I'm going to use these for another stock. Same thing happens. I'm going to cut them in half, each one in half, and then I'm going to julienne them. I'm only going to use about half of these, but I want to use some of the green and some of the white. Fine slicing is going to make my julienne come out very, very nice. When I pull the turtle meat apart, the turtle meat is going to be julienned. It's going to be almost like shredded pork because there's a lot of collagen and a lot of muscle tissue that are long and fibrous. Because the meat is, here again, cooking slow, and in order for it not to be really tough, it's going to come apart. It will have that earthy flavor if you just have regular snapper. The soup itself gets imitated. There's a restaurant in Philadelphia called Bookbinders, and Bookbinders made famous their snapper soup. So much so that the restaurant is gone, but you can still find Bookbinder snapper soup in the can. They sold the license to a producer that makes snapper soup, Bookbinder snapper soup. Philadelphia tradition, there's other operations like Horn and Hardart and McAllister's Caterers, all who are not around anymore, who were made famous by their snapper soup. It's one of those dishes almost uniquely Philadelphia, not completely unique to Philadelphia, but the flavoring and the tradition that goes along with it is very similar. There's still some other restaurants that are still around that have that same reputation for really, really good snapper soup. The generations that eat soup are generally older. They're not, younger people don't go out for snapper soup. They'll eat something else, but this is a very old, traditional type of soup that generally people of older ages are going to understand how important it is to make it from scratch and how impressive it is when you get real snapper soup that has gone through this four or five step process. As I go through cleaning these leeks, because I cut them julienned, they are very, very fibrous. So I will saute these before I add them to the soup. When the stock is finished, the flavor of the soup is there. What I'm going to do is add garnish, my vegetables that I'm doing right now, I'm going to thicken it with a roux, and then I'm going to finish it with the ultimate garnish, which is we use eggs. We use chopped boiled eggs. The reason for that as a garnish is needs a little bit of explanation. When a wild caught turtle is dressed, most times the females are going to have about a dozen to 24, one to two dozen eggs in and around the shell. That's where they store the eggs before they lay the eggs in the nest. They're completely edible, And a lot of times when they're in there, they're very, very soft shelled. And traditionally, when you cook the turtle, you cook the eggs too, and you serve them with the eggs. Because these are dressed and they remove the eggs, we're gonna add chicken eggs. They're already boiled. I'm gonna dice them up and add them as one of the final garnishes to the soup. Okay, gonna peel the carrots. Now, the same, if you look up recipes online for Philadelphia snapper soup, besides that seasoning mix that I had spoken about before, you're gonna see all different types of seasoning mixes. Everybody likes to have their own, make it their big secret. But I'll turn around and say that more than that, you're gonna find more recipes for mock turtle soup than snapper turtle soup. Number one, some people don't have turtles as pets. I have one. We don't like to refer to cutting up my turtle and serving it for soup. It would make my kids traumatized. What I generally like to do is you can buy commercially prepared turtle meat, and that's what almost every recipe online is gonna tell you, buy turtle meat. You can get it usually special order through a seafood distributor or a specialty shop, we'll be able to get it for you. Most people, myself included, when I'm making mock turtle soup, I'm gonna use turkey, veal, or duck, or chicken carcasses and do the same thing with the meat and get nice stringy meat that looks like turtle, but I'm gonna use the same seasoning and almost the same process to make the soup. All right, for my garnish, I'll finish with the carrots. I'm gonna do the same thing to the carrots. I want them slightly julienned, just enough so that the garnishes are gonna look the same. When I cut, remember I've said this before, I don't wanna cut a round carrot on the table because it rolls around. I wanna lay it flat, cut long. Now, the rule is, when you're making garnishes or anything for a soup, you should be able to fit it onto a spoon. So these juliennes, I'm gonna make smaller because these are a little tougher. In other words, the root vegetables that I use are gonna have a little bit more cellulose. When I saute that, that's gonna get soft and pliable. To get these julienne the way I want them, I'm cutting them to a specific size so these can still fit on a spoon and still have the same shape that I want to have as a garnish, because my garnish is going to determine how pretty my soup looks. Same thing, a couple slices, cut on the bias. When you cut vegetables, the idea that you're using with a knife is to make them uniform in size so that they'll cook evenly. I've described that before, where if you have odd-shaped or odd-sized garnish, it's not gonna appear the same way. They're not gonna cook the same. Some will be more well done, some will be less well done. You want the vegetables, because of their size and shape, and you can manipulate them with a knife and make them the same size. You want them to be the same size so that when they're cooked, that they add the flavor. It's, you know, we have a rule that whenever you're sauteing onions and garlic together, you saute the onions first, then add the garlic. Garlic's smaller, but if you don't do it that way, the garlic tends to be bitter and half raw, and the onions will still have an oniony flavor. The garlic will burn quicker than the onions will. Because the onion is used more for flavor than texture, when I saute these will disappear because these have a lighter cellulose than a carrot and less than a leek. These will disappear. I only need about half of an onion. And I'm gonna have some diced celery that's actually gonna show up because of the fibrous nature of the celery. That's gonna show up pretty well. I'm keeping them separate because these, once they're washed, I'll saute these first and then add my onion and my celery. Same way with the celery, I'm just gonna cut them in half, each rib. On the bias, so I get a look that matches to some extent my carrots. Okay, I'm gonna add to that some parsley. I'm gonna finely slice the parsley. This is almost like a chiffonade. Okay. I'll saute that. That's going to show up with color in the finished product. Okay, this is my seasoning. I'm going to take my leeks out of the water. I've agitated them to get all the sand off. And my last garnish, and I'm going to use this the same way, I have cooked, peeled, hard-boiled eggs. The cooked eggs, just like I said before, are an indication that it was a female turtle that was getting ready to lay eggs or is about to lay eggs. And this is the garnish that goes on top of the finished soup. So when I'm finishing the soup, this goes spread on top, and then the last garnish that goes on top is sherry wine poured right over the top of the finished soup. For the amount of soup that I'm going to serve, I need probably half an egg for each serving of soup. And for the amount that I'm making with that size turtle, this is why the bigger soup, you know, the bigger the turtle, the bigger the soup. I have enough soup here for about 15 people from one turtle. Another reason why most recipes are going to give you enough for 6 or 7 people. This is still a big process for a big soup, for a big menu, for a big meal. These eggs will be served at the last minute with my sherry on top of the finished soup. Okay, my eggs are cut, my vegetables are cut. I'm going to saute them now. Now it's time to saute my vegetables. I'm going to start with the leeks. They're going to take the most amount of time to get tender. I'm going to use butter. A little pat of butter, hot pan, cold oil. The butter's not burning, just enough to melt. Because I'm going to use butter for the roux, the excess fat that would come up to the top is going to be absorbed by the flour that I add. Again, I don't want a lot of water in here. Butter is going to add water. So I have this up to a high temperature. I don't want them to caramelize, but I do want the moisture and the heat to break down the cellulose to make it a little more tender. Carrots and root vegetables hold up better in sauce and stock because of the dense cellulose that root vegetables have, as opposed to a tomato, which has a less dense cellulose construction, and that would dissolve with heat and moisture, whereas a turnip, parsnip, carrot, beet, or doesn't have the same cellulose, will hold up better to the heat and the moisture over an extended period of time, just like cooking soup. And you can see them now, they're getting soft and tender, which is kind of what I want. I don't want them burnt. I don't want them completely sauteed down, but this is going to, as I add the heat and a little bit of moisture from washing them off, they're breaking down nicely. To that, I'm going to add the rest of the vegetables that I cut, the onions, the carrots, to the leeks. I'll add some more butter, about another 2 tablespoons, just on the side. That'll add a little bit more fat. Everything is cut so that when it's finished in the pot or finished in the finished pot, all I have to do is then ladle it out and spoon it into the dish, the soup plate, and then you're going to see what the soup looks like when it's complete. This is the same garnish and the same way it's going to look when it's mixed in with the soup. When I add heat like this and the fat, I change the texture of the vegetables so they're partially cooked. This is just like blanching because I'm actually going to end up continuing to cook them in the soup. If I put raw vegetables in a soup, I'll tend to reduce the soup and possibly change the flavor in a negative way if I cook the vegetables in the soup. It's always better to saute for this soup the vegetables separately and then add them and let everything finish at the same time. Flavors will blend as we bring everything back up to temperature. But because this is still hot, I just want this to become tender and so that everything is at the same texture. This is my finished garnish, vegetable garnish for the soup. Again, my pan comes out clean. That's a lovely thing. All right, and the next step in the process is I'll make the roux. My pan's still hot. It still has the flavor that I'm going to use of the vegetables. A roux is a mixture of fat and flour that I'm going to use to thicken my final soup. I'll make the roux now. Here's my flour. Here's my butter. I'm actually just going to take equal amounts, probably half a pound of butter to half a pound of flour, rough estimates. And I want the roux to come out because I have a thin stock that I want to be a little bit more hearty. And as it's thicker, it's actually going to suspend the garnish inside so that everything doesn't sink to the bottom like you would in a chicken noodle soup or an Italian wedding soup. I want it to be a little more thick and a little more hearty. To do that, I want to thicken it. I will use roux as my thickener. I can make this a brown roux. In other words, cook it until it changes color and turns it more rich. That would use that to increase the color or darken the soup. But because I roasted the tomato paste with the turtle, it's going to come out darker anyway. So I can just make a blonde roux. Just enough to stir to make it work. I don't want to burn it. I want the starch to cook out. This will be lumpy. This will still be warm. I'll leave it on the stove. And as I strain the stock and start to put the soup together, and I can put the soup together and then add the turtle meat later, this will help me balance the texture and the amount of liquid to solid in the soup. And here again, I can burn a roux just like I can burn everything else, so I want to keep my eye on it. And as I slowly pull this together, the fat will still absorb more and more of the flour. It turns into a paste. This will be a little more dense. When I add warm roux to warm sauce, it melts completely. When I add cold roux to hot, it tends to stay lumpy until the heat changes and melts the butter and you get lumpy sauces. You're gonna have to strain them anyway. After I make the soup itself and I thicken it, I will strain it. So for all sakes and purposes, I'll take the turtle out of the stock, I'll thicken the stock and then strain the stock. This way I won't have any lumps of roux in my soup. And I'm actually going to take the turtle apart and add the meat, chop it separate, and add it to the finished sauce or the finished soup. When I take the turtle out, I'm actually going to finish the soup right there. What I want from this pot with the turtles in is the stock. And that would end up being the soup as I thicken it, add my garnish, and add my cooked turtle meat. So I can actually finish the soup before I even put the turtle meat back in it. Part of that is cooking the roux. As this roux cooks, just like before, when I'm making stuff flip around in a pan, and the unnatural act of pulling a hot pan towards you will flip everything in the pan right over towards you. This won't stick because of the fat content. And all I want to do is cook as much of the starch out of this as I can. All right, I'll set this up top. I'm going to pull my stock over, and I'm going to check my turtle meat to see if it's done. Just like I opened the lid before, I'm going to open the lid. I'm checking my turtle meat to see if it's tender enough, and this can actually still use some more time. So what I'll do is I'm going to remove the shell. Put that on the side, flip the rest of the turtle over. I've now split the turtle in half. You can tell when the stock's done when the meat comes right off the bone. When the meat falls away from the bone, the stock's pretty much done. I'm about 3/4 of the way there because the turtle itself is actually starting to fall apart. All right, so I'll give that probably another 15 minutes. And I'll be able to remove the turtle from the stock and finish the soup. Now it's time for the final step of the snapper soup. Stock is made. It's time to take the turtle meat out, break down the turtle meat, and then thicken the soup and finish it. We've already sauteed the garnish. We have the chopped eggs already ready. The sherry's ready. That's probably the most important finish part. I'm ready to strain it with my china cap and my bell pot, but the most important part now is cleaning the turtle meat. This is my finished stock. The shell, the tail. I'm gonna use the tongs to pull out the meat. This is my tail. Here's my shell. Now the shell, the shell actually can come right apart. It's just like when you cook any chicken bone. All the individual pieces of the plate, the different plates that hold the shell together are gonna come apart. There's two basic loins in the back of this that are filled with meat that I'm going to clean out. But right now I just wanna get them out of the stock because I want these to cool properly so that I can handle the meat without burning myself. And while this is being cooled, I can strain and thicken the sauce. Or the soup, I'm sorry. This is the saddle, the back end. All the meat's in there. You see how nice and caramel dark this stock turned because of the roasted turtle? Okay, big chunks of turtle meat. The skin protected the flesh. Okay, this I have it almost put together the way it was in the pan. There's the saddle part, here's the neck and the two legs. So what I have left is not gonna be any chunks of turtle meat. Here's a couple pieces of the shell. The big shell that came off. That kind of amazes people when the shell doesn't come off in one piece. Just like a skeleton of any animal, when I cook and add moisture and heat to the connective tissues that hold all the bones together, the bones all fall apart. The same thing happens with the shell of the turtle. It's a bunch of bones held together by collagen and other connective tissues. So when you cook the shell all the way through, it falls apart into pieces. It's kind of what we're counting on. This is my spice bag. Okay, which has all my spices and seasonings in it. One of the things that we can do with this is I can actually take this and squeeze this into the stock if I didn't get enough flavor out of it. But based on the color of the stock and the smell that's in the kitchen, I know this worked. So I'm gonna take this and just put this aside. And if I have to use it again, I can actually use that again the next time I make it and put that in with the roasted turtle and get a little bit more mileage out of that very expensive seasoning. So while the turtle's cooling over here, I'm going to strain this beautiful soup into this strainer. I don't need any of these parts of the stock. These are my onions, my leeks. This is another big plate from the turtle. I don't need any of that. My carrots, my celery. The stock is where all my flavor from all these vegetables, both the roasted ones and the steeped vegetables that went through with the stock, are all hitting the flavor road. I'm scooping this out like this so that I end up with most of the hard part out of the way. I don't need any of this, but I definitely need the liquid. When I shake this, more of the liquid will come out of the bottom. That's kind of what I want. The liquid's the money part. I don't need any of this vegetables or extraneous matter up top. I'll take the rest of the stock, pour it into my strainer, let it all go. All right. And now my strain stock, my turtle I'm going to clean, but while this is going on, I'm going to pour this into a pot on the stove, bring it back up to a boil. I'm going to add my roux. So while this is working, I want this to come back up to a boil. I'll add my roux, thicken it so it's nappe, so it's just thick enough to hold up my garnish and my meat that's inside. While that's coming up to a boil, I'm actually going to clean my turtle meat. This is a little tedious, and there's a few little pointers I have to give you about cleaning turtle meat. Number one, it's going to come out, the skin is going to hold it together, it's collagen rich, which means this actually is, it gets kind of sticky on my fingers because of the amount of collagen that's in here. But on here, I have about 15 or 20 little bones right here that are tiny that I don't want to end up in the soup. So I'm very careful pulling apart chunks and actually muscle groups like this and making sure I don't have any bones attached to it. I'm gonna put the meat in there after I debone it all and take the skin away, and then I'll deal with chopping the meat. And as you can see, I can pull large muscle groups off away from the bone. It's not like other meat. As I'm cleaning it, this is actually flesh. It looks like skin, but it's flesh. And it gets like hard and it gets very stringy when I pull it apart. The skin is like rubber, that just pulls away. This is a large fat globule. Fat has all the flavor that gives it that quote-unquote earthy flavor. Some people get turned off by the smell because it smells like the marsh at low tide, but based on the seasonings that I added to it, the flavor is actually very, very nice, very pleasant. Hearty, but pleasant. Here again, bones, lots of skin. Make sure I don't have any little pin bones, not pin bones, but little knuckle bones from the flesh. This is all waste. Okay, it serves no purpose whatsoever. All right, this is the neck. The neck has long, when I took it up when it was raw and I pushed it, how the neck came all the way out. This is long strips of flesh, very, very stringy. I'll pull this apart when I clean it. Okay, I can also dice that up. I want to make sure I don't have any, there's no little bones in the neck, but lots of little muscle groups. All right, long stringy pieces of flesh. Okay, bones in the neck, the whole basic vertebrae in the neck. Ow, this is still hot. Okay, more neck muscles. It's easy, I can put, squeeze it and tell where the bones are. The flesh off, the flesh is still light colored like tough fish. Just like I said before, it's not gonna have a lot of dark myoglobin type. Any darkness that comes from here comes from the roasting process, the tomato paste, or the caramelization of the vegetables in the pot. I don't want any vertebrae in here. Okay, picking turtle meat is a little bit of a skill. You have to really know what muscle groups are which, so that you're not using, here's the whole saddle. I'll pull the back end off. This is all fat, yum. Not the same kind of fat that I use in the front. Okay, all muscle tissue, bones. You can see how I'm doing this. This is tedious. The stock still hasn't come up to a boil. This is a little darker meat. Not much, but this is darker mainly because this is where I roasted it. This is close to the feet. Slower moving muscles. The darker meat will be closer to the feet and the legs. The slower moving underneath the shell, which was the equivalent of the loin on a land animal. Okay. A lot of the meat was cooked dark because of the roasting process. Okay. The skin, the collagen, if I let this stock chill in the refrigerator, and I'm not using it directly like I am today, it would become almost completely solid based on the amount of gelatin in it. It would be almost like aspic. All right, my stock is boiling. I'm going to turn that down to a simmer. Finish cleaning the meat. Want the skin off. The skin's really rubbery. Doesn't chew well on the tooth. Would give it an off texture. But I don't want the off texture. The usable meat that comes off a turtle is less than half. So because of the weight of the shell, the bones, the skin, other unusable parts, it's about half because weight-wise. The skin's dense. Don't need the skin. Like I said, the flesh comes apart rather easily, but determining what's flesh and what's skin and bones, a whole nother story. When I roast whole pigs, the same thing happens. I get much more use when I buy butchered pieces of meat than if I buy the whole animal and roast the whole animal. The end result, I don't have a lot of meat for the amount of turtle that I started with. This is why the larger turtles will produce more meat. Smaller turtles, less meat. So, now into the shell. This is a big lump of muscle flesh. Okay, I can break this apart and I'll see this is an entire loin of meat that's nice and long and stringy. But I'm basically breaking the back of the turtle, and then I get these two loins of meat. This looks like a fillet, but that's the muscle, that makes the tail move up and down. All right, don't need the shell. Need the tail and the other front leg. So I'm going to end up with probably, out of a 6-pound turtle, probably 2.5 pounds of meat. Not a lot. Less than half. Goes fast. Meat, meat, meat. I can actually do this much quicker, but it's still a little warm. The tail, you don't get a tremendous amount of meat off of, but you have to watch the skin. On the skin are spikes, and the spikes resemble molars. They resemble teeth. And you don't want to bite into one of them, even though it'd be rather soft. It would be a texture issue in the finished product. So right on the end of the saddle, I have two basically big loins. There's one. Here's the other. These are two major muscle groups in the tail. You're going to get that out of the flesh, and then not much else. One on the bottom, on each side, and I'm done with the tail. Okay, that's all the meat that I'm going to get out of that large turtle and all of the other ingredients. Now, let me dice this up. Now, I do this too because even when I dice it, I'm probably still going to find possibly, not really because I'm that good, another bone or two. And if that's when I'll pull it out. If I have another chunk of fat, I'll pull out that piece of fat. This also gives me the opportunity to double check my work to make sure I don't have any skin, chunks of spice, anything that's not going to end up in the beautiful part of the soup on the plate and in the spoon. Okay, just big enough, every piece of meat that I have should be something that goes across a spoon. Shouldn't be any longer or larger than that. Okay, because we're just, like I said, just about at the finish. Okay. Hey, my meat is already cut. This is soup ready. When you look at the proportion, it's about 2 turtle meat to 1 garnish. And because I have it all together, I can actually mix these all together. The only thing I'm not going to add together at this point is my end garnish, because my chopped eggs are going to go on top of the very top of the soup at the very end. This is going to be mixed in with the soup. Okay, a hearty soup. Looks beautiful, smells delicious. The entire kitchen has the entire aroma of this soup, which is beautiful. Let me clean my board. All right. Okay. Now, my soup, it's time to thicken my soup. I have my roux. I'm going to bring this back to a boil, but I want to add the roux slowly. The roux is still warm. My stock is warm. Once I mix this in and I get it to the point where I have no lumps in the bottom, I'm going to bring this back to the stove and bring it up to a boil. A pound of roux will thicken a gallon of liquid. I have about 1/2 pound, and this is about a gallon. I don't want it very, very thick. That would make a thick sauce. Or a thick soup. I want this thick enough to hold up my garnish without being too thick. It will only thicken when I boil it. So this has to return to the stove. And I have to whisk this as it cooks, because as this boils, that roux that I made with the flour and the butter will start to melt and actually integrate into this sauce and thicken. It'll change the nature. It'll actually lighten the color of the soup up just a little bit. When you stir a large pot, there's a rule to keep it from splashing. I stir very fast in the middle and slow around the outside. It'll keep it from sliding and slopping up and bouncing out of the pot and splashing all over me. All right, it's coming together. All right, very high. I want this to boil, because as it boils, the starch is incorporating into the stock and thickening. I want to cook the starch out because I don't want it to be starchy or sticking to my tongue. I got this beautiful garnish and a beautiful finish. So in order to get this where I need to be, it's got to boil just a little bit. While this boils, it's just about there. One of the things that I want to end up doing is I'm going to take this, and as it boils, I'm going to strain it one more time to take any other little lumps of roux out that didn't cook out, that I didn't stir out or cook out, and that I have no other extraneous, not any chunks that I don't want in the soup. As I agitate this and as I stir it, I'm breaking up the lumps of roux so I get a nice even consistency for my soup. I don't want it terribly thick. I just want it thick enough to hold up my garnish. The way you tell is I'm going to use a ladle, and you're going to look at the back of the ladle and see if it coats the back of the ladle. That's nappe. That's how we do this. So I can tell, and also I can tell from pouring it like this, how thick it is. The thickening process, you have to be boiling. It's boiling now. And as I break it up, I'm adding more air to it by whipping it and breaking up the little lumps. I gotta add more at this point because now it'll melt even faster. When you're adding roux, hot roux to hot liquids, cold roux to cold liquids, and it'll thicken without lumps. Now, I may have some other, when I strained this through the china cap or the chinois, it was relative medium holes. I want to put this through a finer china cap or a finer strainer to get the smallest particulates out, because the only particulates I want in the soup are my garnish and my eggs. So I'm going to have a finer strainer, an empty bell pot because of this. It sounds like a bell. All right, this is my finished soup. It's done. All I'm going to do is pour through the strainer. I'll have some lumps of roux in there that I don't want in the finished soup. Just a few. I don't need them. Okay, this is my finished soup. I'm going to add my garnish to my soup. Okay. Now, the finish of the plate. I'm going to finish the plate. My finished snapper soup. Okay. Just thick enough, just short of a stew. Okay. Served with chopped eggs on top and a splash of sherry at the very end. This was a 3-day process. It's the soup of aristocrats during the Revolution. Wipe my rim, make it look beautiful. Chopped eggs, this is the other garnish. Finished with sherry. Absolutely delicious. Old-fashioned Philadelphia style snapper soup. I'm Paul McCormick, a culinary instructor here at the Community College of Philadelphia's Culinary Arts and Hospitality Management Program. Enjoy.